tibio femoral joint between tibia and femur. The name is also given is the knee joint. The old name of this joint is genu joint. Genu means bend. As the leg bend on this point, and it was the old name, that genu joint. Therefore, the blood vessels and nerves supplying this joint name is given geniculate arteries, genicular veins, genicular nerves, with reference to the its old name, genu joint. So now the name is given tibiofemoral joint, or in other words, it is a knee joint. So genu joint explain the names of the arteries, veins, and nerves, why the names given to these arteries which are supplying the, or make anastomosis around the knee joint. Tibiofemoral joint is complex joint with the type of joint. When we talk about any joint, number one is what type of joint it is. Type of joint mean the general anatomy term, that in which classification it fit in the joint classification, and that is the complex joint. Complex joint is that in which the articular disc or meniscus is present. That is the complex joint. In this the meniscus is present. A similar example is temporomandibular joint. That is the joint of the mandible, which is the having the articular disc in it, also a complex joint. So knee joint is complex because there is presence of the menisci in this joint and is part of the knee joint, or tibiofemoral joint. It's complex synovial joint. It is covered over by synovial membrane, so it fit into the synovial joint classification and complex variety. So talking about the joint, number one is the type of joint which we are talking about, complex joint. Second component of the joint is the articular surfaces which are participating in the joint. That is important. Joint is between the ends of the two bones. So one should know the articular surfaces and their detail. So alignment of these articular surfaces in fractures is very important for smooth movements of the joint. If there is malalignment, say if the condyle of the femur or condyle of the tibia is fractured and not fit into its normal position, the movement of the joint will be affected. So articular surfaces should be in congruent or fit to each other during the movement, and there is no difference of the up and down level of the tibial condyle or femoral condyle. They must be in alignment, and that is the goal to achieve the fracture of the knee joint or the bony lower end of the femur or upper end of the tibia. Tibial plateau presents medial and lateral articular surfaces or facets. Tibia has two articular surfaces, facets or concavity for articulation with corresponding femoral condyles. Posterior surface distal to the articular margin display a horizontal rough groove to which the capsule and the posterior part of the tibial collateral ligament are attached. So posterior surface distal to the articular margin, a horizontal rough groove which the capsule and the tibial collateral ligament. Medial articular surface is oval. If you see the medial condyle of the tibia, that is its oval and anteroposterior diameter is long, which means the medial condyle is larger than the lateral condyle. AP diameter of the medial condyle is more as compared to the lateral condyle. So what we say, the medial articular surface is oval shape because the anteroposterior axis is more as compared to transverse axis, whereas the and longer than the lateral articular surface, it is related to the medial meniscus. Lateral articular surface is the lateral articular surface is the more oval and the less oval rather, and the anteroposterior diameter and transverse diameter almost equal. There is a rough area or the between the condyles articular surfaces is narrow centrally, where is the two condyle, in between the two condyles there is an area what the name is given, intercondylar area between the two condyles of tibia. Rough surface area between the condyle articular surface is narrow centrally, where there is an intercondylar eminence projection, as the lateral and medial intercondylar tubercles which are present in the center, that is raised from the surface of the articular surface of the two condyles. Central area is raised, having two tubercles, lateral and medial intercondylar tubercles. They prevent the lateral displacement or medial displacement of the condyle of the femur. Their role is that medial and lateral displacement of the condyle of the femur is prevented by this raised area in the center. Anterior intercondylar area is the widest anteriorly. A depression marks the site of the attachment of the anterior horn of the medial meniscus. There is a triangular anterior condylar area and posterior condylar area. In front of the intercondylar eminence, so between the two condyles, three things are there. In the center, intercondylar eminence having two tubercles. In front of this intercondylar eminence, a triangular intercondylar area. Similarly, a triangular posterior intercondylar area. Anterior triangular intercondylar area is widest anteriorly, and depression marks the site of attachment of anterior horn of the medial meniscus. Behind this, a smooth area receives anterior cruciate ligament. So anterior horn of the medial meniscus, then anterior cruciate ligament, then behind that is the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus attached anterior to the intercondylar eminence. That is in sequence. So anterior triangular wide area, triangular area, there is a anterior horn of the medial meniscus in front. In center is anterior cruciate ligament, and behind that is the anterior horn of lateral meniscus. The eminence with medial and lateral tubercles is narrow central part of the area in center. Raised tubercles are thought to provide a slight stabilization influence on the femur, which I told you that lateral and medial displacement is prevented. Here is shown, these are the two surfaces of the condyles. These are the surfaces of the condyle which is mounted with the meniscus. This is the meniscus, and this is the anterior horn of the meniscus, which is the, and this is the posterior horn of this meniscus, and that is the medial meniscus. Similarly, you can see this medial meniscus. Yes, medial meniscus on the medial condyle. See, this AP diameter is more here. Anteroposterior diameter of the medial condyle of tibia is more, you can see over here, as compared to transverse diameter. But here you can see that AP diameter is, as compared to the medial condyle, is less as compared to the medial condyle. See, this diameter of the lateral condyle and this diameter on the medial condyle, it is more as compared to the lateral condyle, and transverse diameter is this of the lateral condyle, and AP diameter almost equal with a slight difference. But here is not equal. AP diameter more than transverse diameter, and it is more than the lateral condyle. Here one can see that this area, this triangular area, this one, this hole is anterior triangular area, and this one is the posterior triangular area. In anterior triangular area, this is the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus, then the anterior cruciate ligaments, then the anterior horn of the medial meniscus. Similarly, the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus more anteriorly than is the posterior cruciate ligament, then the posterior horn of the medial meniscus occupy the or attached to the posterior triangular intercondylar area. A transverse ligament known as transverse menisco-meniscal ligament connect the two ends of the two menisci with each other. This has been shown over here. The meniscus is more thick at periphery. Here it is more thick toward the periphery, it is more thin toward the center. It is anervous over here, not painful, but on margin it receives the blood supply and can regenerate from here. The posterior horn of the lateral meniscus is attached to the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus is attached to the posterior slope of the intercondylar area. Posterior intercondylar area incline down behind the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus. A depression behind base of medial tubercle is for attachment of medial meniscus. Rest of area provide attachment for posterior cruciate ligament. Femoral surface. Femoral condyle bearing articular surface almost wholly convex. Tibiofemoral congruence is improved by menisci shaped to produce concavity of the surfaces presented to the femur. The combined lateral tibiofemoral surface is deeper. Femoral condyle has a faint groove anteriorly. Anterior, if you observe that femoral condyle, it has a groove anteriorly. These grooves, which are present on two condyles, demarcate femoral, patellar, and condylar surfaces. That is the patellar surface on the femur and the condylar surface on the femur, which are the part behind this groove. Articulate with the tibia, so name it then condylar surface or the tibial articular surface for tibia. Anterior to that is the triangular area. Anterior to the grooves is for patella. Femoral condyles, they are covered over by articular cartilage all around. Menisci are semilunar, half moon like, crescentic, intracapsular. They are inside, obviously, capsule on the surface of the tibial condyle, are fibrocartilaginous laminae. Nature is fibrocartilaginous histologically, inside capsule or crescent shape. They serve to widen deeper and prepare the tibial articular surface that receive the femoral condyles. Peripheral attachment borders are thick, convex. Their free inner borders are thick and concave. Meniscal horn are richly innervated. Central area is devoid of innervation, so provide the painless joint and the movement. This area is anervous. No nerve is present in central area, but horns are rich with nerve. So any stretch on the meniscus will produce a pain due to presence of nerve at the horns. Medial meniscus, number one. Medial meniscus is broader posteriorly, almost a semicircular in shape, This is attached by its anterior horn to the anterior intercondylar area in front of the anterior cruciate ligament. Anterior horn is the floor of the depression medial to the upper part of the patellar ligament. Posterior horn is fixed to the posterior tibial intercondylar area between the attachment of lateral meniscus and posterior cruciate ligament, as shown in the previous diagram. Lateral meniscus, it is the posterior horn, is attached in front of the intercondylar eminence, posterolateral to its anterior cruciate ligament. This posterior horn is attached behind this, in front of the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. Transverse ligament of joint, knee joint connect the anterior convex margins of lateral meniscus to anterior horn of the medial meniscus, as shown in the diagram previously. That is the transverse ligament of knee. Meniscofemoral ligament, there are two meniscofemoral ligament which connect posterior horn of lateral meniscus to the inner aspect of medial femoral condyle, provide stability to menisci. So what is the attachment? Posterior horn of lateral meniscus to the inner aspect of the medial femoral condyle. Then next is the supports of the joint. Supports of joint, when we talk about, they are the three four things. Number one, capsule. Number one. Number two is the ligaments, which are the intra-articular and extra-articular in the knee joint, inside the joint, capsule of the joint, or outside the capsule of joint. There are two variety of ligament which provide the support. Then surrounding muscles of the joint, which surround it, that provide the stability by its contraction. And minor factors are the, what we say, the atmospheric pressure and the menisci, or like by deepening the surface of the tibial articular surface. So number one is the structure which bind the two bones together is always is the capsule. Capsule give the integrity to the joint and give it a shape. So capsule, joint capsule is a fibrous membrane of variable thickness. Anteriorly it is replaced by patellar ligament. You know that the ligament of patelli, that quadriceps tendon that converge on the patella, and from the patella there is the ligament of patelli which extend from the patella to the tibial tuberosity, ligament of patelli. At this area, capsule is not present, where the patella is present and ligament of patelli is present, no capsule, and does not pass proximal to the patella or over the patellar area. Capsule is not here. On the sides of patella, what it is, that the vastus medialis and vastus lateralis, these two muscles give the expansions. The name is given retinacula. Now what is the site of this expansion of medial meniscus? Is from the, say, okay, the medial meniscus is the medial margin of the patella, medial margin of the ligament of patelli, and to the sides, lateral side of the condyles of tibia and the femur. Or here is the ligament which is present on medial side, is the tibial collateral ligament. So it is attached to the tibial collateral ligament. So what is the extent of this expansion of the medial vastus medialis, is which the name is given medial retinacula, is it cover the gap between the patella and ligament and patelli and tibial collateral ligament on the medial side. In between that gap is covered by retinacula by the expansion of the medial vastus medialis, medial retinacula. Similarly, lateral side of the patella and lateral side of the ligament and patelli, that there is a gap, and that gap is covered by the expansion from the lateral meniscus, a lateral that is the vastus lateralis, and vastus lateralis gives the expansion which pass from the lateral border of the patella and ligament and patelli to the fibular collateral ligament, which is extend from the head of fibula to the lateral condyle of the femur along ligament. We'll talk about next. So this gap, so what we can say, whole of the anterior half of the knee joint, in the center there is present patella, ligament and patelli, and right side of this, the right retinacula or the lateral retinacula, and medial side to this, medial retinacula, both are expansions of the vasti, medial vastus medialis, medial retinacula and vastus lateral. Lateral side retinacula is further strengthened by the iliotibial tract, that further strengthen it and overlap it, so it is the further support to this joint. So elsewhere it lies deep to the expansion from the vastus medialis and lateralis. Expansion are attached to the patellar margin, patellar ligament, extending to the corresponding collateral, which are medially tibial collateral and laterally fibular collateral ligaments, as I explained, and distally to the tibial condyle. Below it is attached on each side to the tibial condyles. They form medial and lateral patellar retinacula, the lateral being reinforced by iliotibial tract lateral. Posteriorly, the capsule contain vertical fiber, that posteriorly they are vertically capsule from the articular margin of the femoral condyle and intercondylar fossa. Fiber mainly pass downward somewhat medially. The oblique popliteal ligament is well-defined thickening across the posteromedial aspect of the capsule. There is another ligament which is present on the posterior side of the capsule, oblique popliteal ligament, across the posteromedial aspect of the capsule. It is one of the, actually it is extension from the tendon of semimembranosus, that its tendon expand as oblique popliteal ligament, semimembranous. Medially soft tissue is the, or the ligament is superficial part of the tibial collateral ligament, has vertical and oblique portions. The former pass from medial epicondyle of femur, vertical part, pass from the medial epicondyle of femur to a large insertion on the medial surface of proximal end of the tibial shaft. It extends 5 cm distal to the joint line. 5 cm distal to the joint line. That is a long ligament which is present on medial side, extending from medial epicondyle of femur to the medial surface of the proximal end of tibial shaft. Laterally, fibular collateral ligament arises from the lateral epicondyle of femur posteriorly to the popliteal insertion and just proximal to the groove or popliteus attached to the fibular head. So extension is to lateral epicondyle of femur and below attached fibular head. Then are the these two are fibular collateral and the tibial collateral ligaments. They are are the oblique popliteal ligament. They all are extracapsular ligaments. Intracapsular ligaments are two cruciate ligaments. The name cruciate is given because these two ligaments cross to each other. So for reference to that name is given. Cruciate ligament is named by as they cross each other are very strong, richly innervated intracapsular structure. They are painful and richly innervated. They provide a much stability to the joint. So knee joint is very rarely dislocated due to the, although okay, articular surface of the tibial condyle is not so deep to provide stability to the large femoral condyles, but these are the two ligaments which provide major stability from slipping of the femoral condyle over the tibial condyle. So they are intercapsular. They are named anterior and posterior with reference to their tibial attachments. Tibia, anterior cruciate attached to the anterior intercondylar area, and the posterior cruciate attached to the posterior intercondylar area. So with reference to that, their names are anterior and posterior. Here is shown the, this one is the anterior cruciate arising from the anterior triangular area attached to the femur condyle, medial condyle, and the posterior cruciate which arises from posterior intercondylar area attached to the lateral condyle. And the, this is the meniscus which is shown. This is the posterior cruciate which is. So you can see the picture that they are crossing with each other and they are providing the much stability to the joint and prevent its dislocation. These are the menisci which are shown over here. This is the transverse menisco-meniscal ligament in between the two menisci, hold the two menisci with each other. This is the medial meniscus, lateral meniscus with reference to the fibula. Fibular side is the lateral and tibial side is the medial. Next. Anterior cruciate ligament is attached to the anterior condylar area of the tibia, just anterior slightly lateral to the medial intercondylar tubercle, partly blending with lateral femoral condyle, whereas it is attached to the lateral surface of the medial femoral condyle and stand on to the anterior part of the roof of the intercondylar fossa.